Good evening. I'm Ashley Windrow, the program coordinator of 92Y Talks. On behalf of the 92nd Street Y, we are delighted to welcome you to tonight's program co-presented with The Common Good. On the day after the midterm elections, we're thrilled to have Director James Clapper and John Brennan for this important and timely discussion on national security and the challenges we face as a nation. Our format tonight is a moderated discussion followed by your questions, which we invite you to write on the cards you've been handed. Before we bring out our speakers, I want to turn this event over to Patricia Duff, the founder of The Common Good. Patricia has extensive experience in the political and policy arenas, from senior staff positions for an investigative committee under the U.S. House of Representatives to two of the nation's premier political strategy firms, and work for several presidential campaigns. She is also a member of the Council on Foreign Relations and Georgetown University's School of Foreign Service Board of Advisors. Now, please give a warm 92Y welcome to Patricia Duff.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Ashley, and thank you to the 92nd Street Y for partnering with the Common Good. We are thrilled to present one of the nation's top leaders in intelligence, James Clapper, and our moderator tonight, the man so many of us wake up to each weekday morning, CNN's John Berman. Yes, we really appreciate the opportunity to collaborate with the Y tonight, especially on the heels of such an anxious election day. At least it was anxious for me. So much was riding on these midterms. At the Common Good, we push for greater engagement in advance of election day, starting with voting. And we certainly had a tsunami yesterday of voting, an historic high water mark for midterm voter turnout. Newbie candidates running and winning who are more reflective of the diversity of our country, and really great news, over 100 women are projected to take seats in Congress. Yes, shattering records and making history. But yesterday's tsunami was also an engagement. Folks were not just running for office, they were organizing, canvassing, knocking on doors, writing postcards, making phone calls, urging folks to vote. Remember the days when political candidates just bought TV and radio ads and sent flyers in the mail to passive citizenry? That's changing. We are seeing bottom-up involvement in the electoral process, and we need it. With government and a people divided and often in gridlock, we will need continued active participation going forward. Here at the Common Good, since our inception, we say democracy is not a spectator sport. Each of us has to get in the ring, get informed, get engaged, and be instruments of change. So tonight, we celebrate our democracy and we salute those in the audience who are those agents of change, giving their time, their money, their sweat, and their smart thinking. I know most of you here are involved in some way or another. You are helping make the difference. So let's not give up now. Don't stop showing the best of what it is to be a citizen in America. I just want to acknowledge a couple of people who have served in government who are here tonight. First, for our nation, Ambassador Jane Hartley, former U.S. Ambassador to France. Maureen White, who served at the State Department on refugee and other issues. And there are many, many activists and other folks in the audience who have served in a variety of different ways, and too many to name. But I do want to say that while the press remains under attack in the U.S. and abroad, we must also acknowledge members of the Fourth Estate and the media, lapsed or current. Thank you to John Berman, Joe Connison, Gail Sheehy, Judith Miller, Nancy Collins, Tom Rogers, Felicia Taylor. Welcome tonight. We are very grateful for the important role that you play in our democracy. So thank you all for being here tonight. I'm looking forward to Director Clapper's remarks. And then Director Clapper will be joined on stage with one of CNN's very best, John Berman, for more conversation. Thank you so much in advance, John. But now it is time for our special guest. Former Director of National Intelligence, Jim Clapper, has more than 50 years of experience working in the U.S. intelligence community. For 7 years, Director Clapper served as the nation's top intelligence official and the principal advisor to the president. He was director of key intelligence agencies under Presidents George H.W. Bush, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, and Barack Obama. He oversaw one of the broadest portfolios in the entire government. All 17 U.S. intelligence agencies, including the CIA, NSA, FBI. He managed 107,000 intelligence employees and a $52 million budget. After years of loyal service, he has chosen to use his civic voice with the publication of his book, Facts and Fears, Hard Truths from a Life in Intelligence. If you haven't already read the book, I hope you will do it today. It's riveting. His insights on our national security and intelligence gathering have been priceless to our country for decades. We are truly fortunate and extremely honored to welcome Director Jim Clapper.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Wow. Thank you very much. It's a great honor to have been invited to speak tonight. And I do want to commend Patricia for the great work she does to promote civil dialogue, if you will. So I'm going to speak very, very briefly about the book, and then John will be out, and then we'll get into a Q&A session. I thought what I would do, though, is share a very important vignette in the book. And it speaks to the huge influence that my parents had on me, particularly my father. And if your father is still alive, next time you see him, give him a hug. I didn't realize just how much influence, impact my dad had on me until I actually had the opportunity to contemplate writing the book. So I thought I'd share with you a vignette that I portray in the book about the when I first knew I was going to be an intelligence officer. By way of background, my dad was a signal intelligence officer in World War II, and when everybody else was demobilizing, he stayed in the Army because he was so captured by the work that he did during the war, which was collecting German and Japanese messages and gleaning intelligence from them to support the combat effort. And again, he was really struck by that. So after the war, he stayed in. So the custom in our family, and my dad served for 28 years retiring as a colonel in the Army. And the custom in our family was that whenever we went to a new duty station, moving from post to post, my parents would park my sister and me at one of the grandparents. They would go off to the next duty station, get a place to live, get settled, then come back and retrieve us. So that's what we were doing in 1953. I was 12 years old, do the math. We were moving from Hokkaido, Japan, where my dad was number two in an Army signal intelligence unit collecting against the Russians. And we were headed to Fort Devens, Massachusetts. So my parents dropped my sister and me at my parents' house in Philadelphia. The big novelty of the day was television. We didn't have television in Japan at the time. This is early 50s. And of course, as I've learned now, and as many of you already know, the first line in the job description of grandparents is spoil the grandkids. So I basically, my grandparents said, you know, I was very interested in television and watching it and all that, so I was allowed to stay up as late as I wanted and watch TV. So the first Friday night I was there, I watched an old movie, and after the movie went off about 12:30 in the morning, I thought, well, I wonder what else is on. Now, in those days, you actually had to walk up to the TV and turn the selector dial. You couldn't sit in the chair with a remote. So I walked up, turned the channel between 4 and 5. I remember this. There were only 4 channels then in Philadelphia. And anyway, I heard talking between channel 4 and 5. No picture, no video. Just talking. So I just stood there and held the selector dial between those two channels, and I figured out that it was the Philadelphia Police Department dispatcher. Well, in those days in Philadelphia, there's all kinds of mayhem going on Friday nights. You know, shootings and police chases and bar fights and domestic disputes. So I listened to this for about 10 or 15 minutes. Pretty soon my hand was getting tired, so I ran out to the kitchen, got a bunch of toothpicks, and stuck them in the selector dial. So I guess I hacked my grandparents' TV set. So I stayed up till 3 or 4 in the morning just listening to this because, you know, what you could figure out what was going on by just listening. So the next day, I scrounged a map of the city of Philadelphia with my grandfather. And I started plotting out the addresses of the police calls. You know how police departments will use what they call brevity codes, like 10-4, 10-6, 10-8. So I got some 3x5 cards and started keeping records of those so I could figure out what those brevity codes meant. Then I learned that every officer in the grade of lieutenant and above in the Philadelphia Police Department had his or her own unique call sign, to include the police chief. So I could figure out what the threshold was for getting him out of bed. So pretty soon I'm sleeping all day and staying up all night, and I got my map and my cards and all this, and I figured out what the police district boundaries were. I figured out how they assigned police cars to each district, what the high crime areas were and all this sort of thing. So about 3 weeks later, my parents came back from Fort Devens. They had a place to live and to retrieve my sister and me. So my dad, just to make conversation, says, "So, what have you been doing?" So I whip out my map, my 3x5 cards, and I gave him about a 20 or 25 minute discourse on how the Philadelphia Police Department was organized, how it operated, high crime areas, police district boundaries, the whole thing. And you know, it was 65 years ago, but I'll never forget the expression on my dad's face. "My God, I raised my own replacement." So that's when I first knew I was going to be an intelligence officer. Anyway, that experience, I didn't know. That's actually sort of the basic unclassified version of, you know, how we do SIGINT yet today. And for intelligence people, you're trying to glean information from less than complete facts. You're always dealing with uncertainty. You develop hypotheses and then test them. And that's kind of the nature of intelligence work. So let me segue real quickly to the book. Most of it is about 75%, I guess, is the last 10 years of my 50 or so in intelligence, when I served as the Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence in the Pentagon, and then almost 6.5 years as the Director of National Intelligence. And so a good part of the book is about that. And I would just highlight for you, clearly the high point of my tenure as DNI was the takedown of Osama bin Laden on the 2nd of May of 2011. Fantastic template, textbook example of a partnership between intelligence and special operations. It was a tremendous operation. I'd been closeted in the White House Situation Room all day long, about 13 hours, and when it came time for the president to deliver his address that Sunday night, announcing officially of the takedown, when we were reasonably sure it was him. And I remember walking out of the West Wing, across the portico by the Rose Garden to the East Room, where he was going to give the speech. And I opened the door, and of course, word had gotten out, and there was a big crowd in Lafayette Park across the White House chanting USA, USA, USA. And it really hit me, big impact. It was closure for the nation, closure for the intelligence community, and certainly closure for me. That was the high point. The low point had to be Edward Snowden and the aftermath of that, and the revelations that he caused, which if you're a taxpayer, you are paying for recovery from the damage he's done to our foreign intelligence collection capabilities, and will be for some time to come. I do a lot of college and universities, sometimes run into assertions by students that he is a hero. It really wasn't. I don't believe if what he had exposed only related to so-called domestic surveillance, air quotes, I could perhaps understand it, but he exposed so much else and did so much damage to our foreign intelligence capabilities had nothing to do with domestic surveillance, so-called. The most frustrating thing was, I'll keep this real brief, not knowing completely who's in the room, is dealing with the Congress. Particularly the last year or year and a half, as the Congress got more and more dysfunctional. Most interesting experience during that time was my trip to North Korea in November 14 to bring out two of our citizens who were imprisoned under hard labor conditions. It was a very interesting experience. I served in South Korea in the mid-80s as the Director of Intelligence for U.S. Forces Korea, and sort of always followed the peninsula ever since. Was always on my professional, not personal, professional bucket list to go to North Korea. Really had huge impact on me, changed my views about North Korea and perhaps what we ought to do about North Korea. The most disturbing thing and the major catalyst for writing the book was the Russian interference in our election in 2016. I've seen a lot of bad stuff in my 50 plus years in Intel, but nothing that bothered me and that disturbed me viscerally as much as the Russian interference in 2016. And, you know, we can talk about all that. That was a major stimulus for writing a book. I wasn't gonna write a book, but I then decided when I saw that I had to do my little part to try to educate the American public about the profound threat posed by Russia to our fundamental political system. So with that, I think I will stop and ask John to join me out here.
I think more than anything, Vladimir Putin would be thrilled to know that you learned how to spy on him on your grandfather's TV. Reassured, maybe, more than anything. So, with 50 years in public service, I was struggling with where to start this conversation, and then today happened. So, Director, I want to begin by treating this as if you were on my show tomorrow morning, which, for the record, we tried to get him on the show tomorrow morning, but he can't make it. So let me just ask you off the bat. The president more or less fired the Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, turned over oversight of the entire Russia investigation and Robert Mueller to his chief of staff, Matt Whitaker. When you saw that news, what was your reaction?
Well, first, it wasn't a surprise. It shouldn't have been a surprise to anyone. I mean, the president's been subtle like a freight train on his, you know, regard for the Attorney General, who, by the way, did precisely the right thing by recusing himself when he did. That was the right thing to do, which, of course, displeased the president. So, the obvious concern is what happens now, particularly with respect to the Mueller investigation. How long would Mr. Whitaker be acting before the president would nominate either him or somebody else to permanently fill the position? Probably no such thing. You probably shouldn't use the word permanent with any cabinet official in this administration. So the obvious, certainly the concern I have, and I think everyone does, is what is the potential impact on the Mueller investigation?
One of the things is congressional oversight, which will be different starting January when the Democrats take over the House. But the Senate still plays a role, and you write about it in the book, and you've talked about it on television. Just tell people what Mitch McConnell's reaction was when you spoke to him in the fall of 2016 to go over your concerns about the Russian attack on the U.S. election.
Well, I didn't actually personally engage with him about this, but I will just say the Republicans in general were less than interested in working with the White House on a by-branch basis, legislative executive branch, because what the White House wanted to do, led by the superb Chief of Staff Dennis McDonough at the time, was to go out with a joint statement to the American public about the Russian interference in the election. And I remember distinctly briefing teams that we sent up to the Hill to brief who were enjoined by certain members in both houses not to be used as tools or pawns by the administration by pushing this narrative about Russian interference. So there was a general aversion to saying much about on a bilateral basis, that is legislative and executive branch.
You know Robert Mueller, but you have not spoken to him since he took over this investigation.
Happily, yeah.
Based on your knowledge of how he works, where do you think he is?
Well, he's he's closer to the end than he is the beginning, I'll put it that way. I do know Bob pretty well from having worked with him in a couple of capacities when he served as director of the FBI for 10 years as a term, and he got extended for 2 years. And that was a brilliant choice, in my view. I mean, his character and integrity and honesty and his dedication to public service is just unparalleled. And I also know that he is very methodical, very systematic, and very thorough. And I think he will, run whatever evidence trails there are to a conclusion, if he's left to do that. But I do think he's drawing closer to the end. I can't give you a date, but that's more instinct than anything empirical.
Your work on all of this at the beginning when you were DNI was highly classified, and then after government, in dribs and drabs, in interviews, we began to know where your head was on parts of it, the part that you could tell us. Some of your public statements early on were, and the White House has made a lot of this over time, I've seen no evidence of collusion. That was more than a year and a half ago when you publicly said that. But if you read the book and you listen to what you say on CNN these days, your views have evolved some. And in the book, you in fact go as far to say as you have seen evidence that the Russian efforts may have been, I don't know if the word is decisive, but effective.
Oh, absolutely. In the book, I spend a whole chapter on the striking parallels and similarities between things that the Trump campaign was saying and doing and things that the Russians were saying and doing, particularly with respect to marginalizing or demeaning Hillary Clinton any way they could. And there were really striking thematic parallels. The language usage was very parallel. So I did not see evidence that I thought would meet the whatever the evidentiary bar is for collusion, which really isn't, there is no such term legally as collusion. But in a common understanding of it, we just didn't see any incontrovertible evidence of that. One could argue that then candidate Trump's statements in July of 17, when he exhorted the Russians to go find the 30,000 emails, some would say that's connotes collusion. I don't know if that meets the legal litmus test or not. The point I do make in the book, which is probably the most controversial assertion, is that I believe because of the magnitude of the Russian effort and its diversity, the multidimensional aspects of it, and the fact that their messaging reached, we believe, about 123 million people, and their very astute, sophisticated, and pervasive use of social media, that I believe they actually turned the election. Now that is what I would call an informed opinion. Others have since written about that, making the same point. And I have to be very clear that in the intelligence community assessment that we produced on January 6th of 2017 and came up here and my one and last sojourn to Trump Tower, briefed then President-elect Trump on it, that we made no call whatsoever on what impact the Russian interference had on the election. But as John alluded, and with what I've learned since then and what I saw before I left the government, I'm convinced the Russians really had a huge impact on the outcome of the election. That's not in any way to indict anyone who voted for President Trump. What it is an indictment of is the Russians and what they did and the profound threat that it poses to our system.
Do you have concerns given the firing of Jeff Sessions and given the actions that we all see the president taking, that the public may never know what Robert Mueller is finding out?
Well, I think at some point, if it is suppressed or kept secret initially, that just the way things are in Washington, it'll get out. Mm-hmm. And so we will ultimately know, I think, what he found. My speculation, that's all this is that he would, if you think of him, and I do at least, analogous to the FBI, that he would do a referral to the Department of Justice. And then the Department of Justice has to decide whether to prosecute or not. And of course, if in fact, and I don't know this, if there's charges against the president, the referral in this case would be to the Congress, specifically the House of Representatives, which of course is now controlled by the Democrats. So you can spin out a scenario here, we all can, about how that will happen, but I don't know. I'm just speculating.
You're all cheering, which I take as somewhat a geographic statement as much as anything, being on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. But yes, the Democrats will be taking over the House, but I will note with Matt Whitaker now as the recipient of the report that Robert Mueller might give, we don't know how far it gets after that. We don't know where the referral...
Well, if actually the recipient would be Rod Rosenstein as the Deputy Attorney General.
One of the things that happened today is that Whitaker was given oversight of all the Russia things. Rosenstein is out of the chain of command.
Oh, is that right?
Russia.
Well, that's the news to me.
And no, it's complicated. And these are one of the things. You'll have to tune in to New Day tomorrow at 6 a.m. to find out exactly where that's headed. But there are a lot of legal questions still having to do with that. I'm sure many of your questions might be about Mueller, so I'm going to move off of that. As we sit here, what's the date today? November 7th. Do you have security clearance?
I do.
You were on the list.
Yes.
To have it revoked.
Well, I have fairly recent information that tells me that I still have it.
And
probably all I ought to say about it.
Do you think it was an empty threat?
At the time, I don't think it was, but I think they went on to other things. You know, they just got other distractions.
Do you care?
About that?
Yes.
Not really. I haven't had occasion to use it. I should first explain why is it that former senior officials keep their accesses. It's simply a convenience for people who are current incumbents to be able to call on people that had the jobs before for, you know, corporate memory. what I used to get when I have my predecessors come in, you know, what on earth led you to make that decision, sort of thing. And it was really healthy to have that, counsel that you could draw on from former. So that's why it's done. Will the Republic stand or fall on whether or not I have a top secret access or not? Of course not. So it was somewhat, empty threat. I still have it, but I have not had occasion thus far to use it.
Now?
Oh, I will say, I have been called upon by certain senior officials in the current administration for advice. It didn't require clearance, and I certainly will not name them to protect them.
Your name has been on another list recently also, and maybe not completely unrelated, frankly, which is that you were one of the people, the individuals that had a bomb mailed to you. How did that feel?
Well, the most disconcerting thing about it was my wife and I were traveling. We have a little vacation place down in the Outer Banks in North Carolina, and so we were driving down there the Wednesday the 24th, I guess, when the first news of the pipe bombs and of course the dramatic evacuation of CNN occasioned by a pipe bomb addressed to John Brennan.
Misspelled.
His name was misspelled and they had the wrong network. At least in my case, he spelled my name correctly and got the right network.
It's the little things.
Yeah. Anyway, the most disconcerting thing about it, I will tell you, was that first day, and I had, you know, we called our next door neighbor, who for 20 years has retrieved our mail. because I figured that if John got one, that if this guy had others on his list, I was probably on it. So it wasn't a big surprise. And that was probably the most disturbing thing about it was having to call our next door neighbor and who, you know, kind of pay a price for living next to us and warn him about, you know, don't go near our mailbox.
That's a really good point. You know, I think you expect a certain level of scrutiny and perhaps danger, a career in the military and journalists, we go to dangerous places all the time, but at the building, the Time Warner Center, where one of the devices was sent, there are all kinds of people who work in that building, office workers at the Whole Foods downstairs, and the whole complex had to be evacuated there.
Well, not to blow smoke, John, but I thought CNN did just a phenomenal job of continuing to report, even while evacuating the Time Warner building here, and I thought Jim and
Poppy.
Jim Sciutto and I guess it was
Poppy Harlow.
Poppy Harlow did a phenomenal job.
You can blow smoke. We could use a little more smoke. I appreciate that. In this,
by the way, I have to say, Truth in Advertising. I'm under contract CNN, which is a phenomenal organization, and I'm really proud to be a part of it.
How do you explain how it is now that you are a public figure and a matinee idol? On the Upper East Side, when you spent your whole career, you know, being a secret agent man, a spy in the scenes, I mean, did you ever think you were going to be a public figure?
No. I managed to pretty much stay below the radar, stay anonymous, up until I became a DNI. And to be quite candid, people in the intelligence business really aren't prepared to deal with the media, which I learned the hard way when I was at the DNI. And I explained earlier my background, you know, so it's almost genetically antithetical to me to speak out. And I kind of backed into this, frankly, because my initial intent when I left the government was simply to try to defend the intelligence community. That's all I wanted to do. So this, there's a consequence of the book and being on CNN. I have far more notoriety than I ever had when I was in the
Maybe more than you wanted. Do you feel any unique pressure, though? Because I do get the sense that there are people, and we journalists get it to a much lesser extent, that people look to you, particularly people who aren't fans of this administration, as somehow a defender of the republic. You are the last line of defense. We're counting on you. Well, to save us. And I'm not saying I agree with that, but you have that sentiment out there.
Well, that's a lot of people say that. It's very heavy. That's a big responsibility. I will tell you, to be honest, that I've gotten pushback from speaking out, but from my two tribes, meaning some former senior military officers and some former senior officials in the intelligence community who don't think that I or John or Mike Hayden or any of us should be speaking out as we do. And so when I've been asked about it, I said, look, this is a very personal decision. And in my case, when I saw the institutions and the values of this country, which I spent over 50 years defending, coming under assault as they have been, both externally and internally, I felt it was my duty to speak out.
Thank you. It's particularly interesting if you read the book because during your years in intelligence, you were very deeply committed to the idea of providing unvarnished intelligence without necessarily, forget political, recommendations and even policy recommendations. All you were trying to do, religiously in some cases, was just provide the intelligence. Explain that.
Well, there's almost holy writ in the intelligence profession. And by the way, I do consider it a noble profession, a sacred public trust. But there's almost a writ that you tell truth to power and you don't engage in policy. Now, sometimes, you know, the higher you go, that gets harder and harder, and it certainly was as DNI, trying to maintain that distinction. But that's It's very important. I got in trouble sometimes particularly in open testimony in Congress, which I always liken to a root canal or folding fitted sheets. And I remember one vignette, and this is a great John McCain story. God rest his soul. I love John McCain. Anyway, I was testifying, this is like 2011 or so, or 2012, before his committee, Senate Armed Services Committee, and I think it was Senator Lieberman was on the committee at the time, asked me, and this was when all the upheaval was going on in Libya, and Senator Lieberman asked me, well, how's this gonna come out? Who's gonna win? And I responded that unless the opposition got some help, that the regime, and then Gaddafi, was gonna prevail. Well, the wrath of God came down on me from the White House because that wasn't exactly company policy. And Senator Lindsey Graham was on television almost immediately afterwards, and wasn't the first time, or the last time either, recommending I resign. That night, back in the office about 7:30, I got a call from Senator McCain. And he said, don't you ever compromise yourself. You always must tell truth to power. He said, 99 times out of 100, I'm gonna agree with Lindsey Graham. You know, as you know, he and I are good friends. But this is one case, I love this turn of phrase, he shot from the lip. But I never forgot that exhortation from John McCain to, as an intelligence officer, you have to tell the unvarnished facts, tell truth to power, whether the power listens to the truth or not.
Talked about your relationship with Congress, and it's a good time to talk about that because Congress is changing over the next 2 months. You've had a complicated relationship with Congress over the years.
Yes, say the least.
Do you trust Congress?
Yeah, here's, you know, I trust members individually, and I know members individually, several of whom are good friends of mine. I don't trust Congress institutionally, or my trust level has gone down a lot with the Congress. The Congress, I think, to this point, has failed to exercise its responsibilities for maintaining the checks and balances. You know, that was the brilliance of the Founding Fathers, to have three co-equal branches of service, branches of government, and that hasn't worked too well. I expect that's going to change now with the House.
To be fair,
by the Democrats, even though the president's made it clear that he's not going to deal with them if they investigate him.
You had issues with Democratic members of Congress too, though. Some of your toughest moments came under questioning from Democrats.
Well, yeah, the famous exchange I had with Senator Wyden in March of 2013. And Senator Wyden, of course, a Democrat, asking about mass surveillance and what you never see in the YouTube video that's widely circulated is a rather meandering preamble about, and he used the word dossier twice, you know, different meaning then.
Yeah, before dossiers became hip.
And then basically what happened, just to cut to the chase here, is I just wasn't thinking about what Senator Wyden was asking about. So I made a big mistake, which I've certainly publicly acknowledged many times. He was asking about the storage of limited telephony business records metadata by NSA, covered by what was then called Section 215 of the Patriot Act. And I was thinking about something we had just gotten renewed, Section 702 of the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. This is kind of arcane law here. And that law governs the collection of non-US persons overseas. So that's what I thought he was asking me about. And he was asking about something else. So it came across that I lied. Well, I didn't lie, I made a big mistake. And just on its face, you know, I've testified to Congress maybe 20, 25 years, probably answered hundreds, thousands of questions, either orally or in writing. But, you know, gee, just for a change of pace, I think I'll lie on this one question and do it on live television in front of one of my oversight committees. Really? So, yeah, I made a mistake, but I didn't lie. And by the way, even if I had been on the same page with Senator Wyden, he kind of set me up for this, the program at the time was classified. So even if I had understood what he was asking about, I still couldn't, I still had trouble. I'd have still been in a bad place.
One of the great features of your book, incidentally.
Yeah, this is all in the book. Yeah. You know, all the warts are there too.
But that's the point, is you own a lot of what you consider to be mistakes. And in this political climate, you don't see a lot of our leading politicians say, I blew that.
Yeah.
It's refreshing. Well,
thanks.
Yeah.
Not a politician, obviously.
obviously not. When you were talking in your speech, and I was listening from backstage, you put domestic surveillance. You kept on saying domestic surveillance in air quotes. Why the air quotes?
Well, it's a very sensitive thing in the intelligence community to make that perfectly clear. The reason that program, which of course obviously since been declassified, the reason that program was instituted was to connect the dots between a foreign communicant who was plotting with somebody located in the United States. And the reason for the law, the Patriot Act, and that particular provision was to allow the intelligence community, if needed, to quickly make a connection between a foreign communicant plotting something in the United States, which is exactly what happened to us in 9/11. So that's the reason for it. Where we made a mistake, we, the intelligence community, is in not being more transparent about it. Had we explained why this thing was needed, I'm sure we could have got a law passed big enough to drive a truck through that would accommodate that, and it would all have been kind of out in the open. And I'm convinced that people would not be any more concerned about that than they would be about the fact that the FBI maintains millions of fingerprints on millions of innocent people. But people know about it, and they understand why it's done. So the lesson learned for the intelligence community is the need to be more transparent.
Do you think intelligence gathering is a noble profession?
Is that a question?
Yes.
Yes, I do. And I will tell you that a lot of that, I think, why I feel that way rises from my father. As I indicated earlier, now I realize what tremendous impact he had on me, and he's been dead for 15, 16 years. And I think he instilled that in me at a very young age. He never, forced me to, I want you to go to West Point or whatever. He never did that. But just by the way he approached his work and the fact he stayed in the Army after World War II to continue, I just think that was inculcated in me and it's kind of instinctive. So for me, it's part of my being. I believe that intelligence is a noble profession. And I appeal to young people that way who are interested in it. You know, the opportunity to be part of something bigger than yourself, to help keep the nation safe and secure. Sure, we've made mistakes and done things that were illegal either at the time or later on were judged to be illegal. But even so, with all those issues, that I think one of the reasons why the United States is what it is today is because of our intelligence capabilities, which the American taxpayer has seen fit to invest in.
Do you think our capabilities are at risk because of the current political climate surrounding intelligence gathering?
What I don't worry about intelligence gathering so much as I do worry about the ability of the people, the great men and women who are in the intelligence community today, to continue to tell truth to power. That could be pretty challenging, I suspect, in this administration. Maybe not, I don't know. I will say for President Obama, in the 6.5 years I worked for him, he was very conscientious about that. Made it very clear that he wanted the unvarnished word, the best information that the intelligence community had, untainted by any political aspects. And on occasion, that required me or others to deliver bad news to him, you know, things that weren't working so well. You know, this policy is shaky. And that, you know, some that's hard to do, but he was great about that. And I hope that continues. I certainly, when I wrote a note to the President-elect Trump then, okay, when he was going to receive his first President's Daily Brief, and emphasized the importance of truth to power, and it was my hope that he would not only accept truth to power, but encourage it. Well, I was, you know, maybe I was a little naive then, you know.
He seemed to take the note to heart, I think.
Yeah.
He keeps it at the bedside table and reads it every night. I want to talk about North Korea.
Sure.
Because George Clapper's one of the few Americans who's been to North Korea, which is fascinating in and of itself. 2014, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Let's start for now and then work backwards. Kim Jong-un. I'm sure he saw the election results overnight. What do you think he makes of the all of a sudden divided government?
I think the way he looks at it is, or the way North Koreans do, is this is actually represents a lessening of the president's power, since he no longer controls one house of the Congress. So that for him, this could be, I'm speculating here, but just knowing somewhat how North Koreans think, that this will be an occasion for kind of stretching out whatever, this hit and miss dialogue we have. He's perfectly happy to have, theatrical events for summits. But I think it'll, denuclearization, that's not going to happen in my lifetime, I don't think. So he'll play along. You know, Kim Jong-un is not term limited. He's a very young guy, so he's looking at the long game. And for him, the long game is the rest of his life, which could be 30 or 40 years at least. And so he'll just kind of wait us out.
Well, to that point, there was news today, and I may not get it 100% right because there was a little bit of other news today that I was focused on. But from what I could tell, some prospective meetings on North Korea with Secretary Pompeo and Kim got delayed. They're not happening, and the North Koreans are not happy today with what the United States is doing or not doing. Are you surprised by the pace or by how this has evolved over the last month or two?
No, this is kind of standard operating procedure. It's one step forward, two steps back with the North Koreans. You know, the primary interlocutor for Secretary Pompeo, who was to meet with him here in New York, was Kim Jong-chul. He was my primary interlocutor when I was there in 2014. Now, he was in a different capacity then. He was wearing a uniform, and he was head of what they call a Reconnaissance General Bureau, which is the North Korean version of the GRU, the Russian Military Intelligence Organization, which combines intelligence and special operations. Kim Jong-chul touted himself as my counterpart when I went there. He was very acrimonious. He is staunchly anti-American. Anti-South Korean, so it kind of amazed me when I saw him elevated to number two in the Korean Workers' Party, and that he was the emissary to go to Seoul for the Winter Olympics. He, of all people, he was nasty. It was very acrimonious discussion that I had with him. So I am not surprised that a staunch anti-American is prominent from the North Korean side in terms of negotiating with us, and which tells me that this is going to take a long time and a lot of patience.
In the short term, they haven't had any tests.
That's right.
And that's not a bad thing, you see.
It is a good thing. We haven't had missile tests. We haven't any underground nuclear tests. They returned 55 remains from the Korean War. They returned two hostages. They've toned down the rhetoric, certainly with the South Koreans. And amazing to me is the image of KPA, North Korean soldiers, and ROK soldiers, South Korean soldiers, in the DMZ demining. And they've agreed to remove all the guard posts from around the, what's called the joint security area near Panmunjom and Jom. So it's really amazing change in behavior of Kim Jong-un. Now you might ask, why the change? My own view is, has nothing to do with the tweets. What it does have to do with is that, in my view, the North Koreans achieved whatever it is they think they needed to achieve in the way of a nuclear deterrent. Now they might not grade it or gauge it the way we would in terms of an operational complete weapon system. But in their minds, and deterrence is all about psychology, they've achieved what they believe is a nuclear deterrent. And I think that's what occasioned the moderating behavior of Kim Jong-un and the North Koreans. So for the first time, they can come to the table not as a supplicant, which has always been the case in the past whenever we've had dialogue with the North Koreans about denuclearization. When I was there, my first White House talking point that I was to recite to the North Koreans was, you must denuclearize before we'll negotiate with you. Well, it took me about 5 minutes to conclude that that was a non-starter. North Koreans are not going to do that because that's their ticket to survival. They went to school on Muammar Gaddafi, and things didn't turn out so well for him. They know all that. So I can't conceive of them willingly and certainly quickly giving up whatever nuclear capability they have.
You were the fourth director of national intelligence, the fourth DNI, but in some ways, the first that clicked, the first that lasted any length of time, and maybe the decisive one, because had it not succeeded for you, it might have gone away completely. Is it a position, or what will make that position continue to work, or why do you think it is necessary?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I need to make clear that when I was first asked about it, I did not want to take the position. It was Bob Gates, who was then Secretary of Defense, that asked me about it, and I said no, because at the time, I was pushing 70 years old, now I'm dragging it. And I didn't want to go through another confirmation or any of that. Well, when they run you in the Oval Office, and I didn't know President Obama, he didn't know me, but you know, we kind of clicked and he hired me on for 6.5 years. The 9/11 Commission, which investigated the 9/11 attacks, concluded that what the US intelligence community needed was a person who could full-time, on a full-time basis, promote integration, coordination, collaboration across the multiple components of the U.S. intelligence community as a full-time job. And I believed in that, and so I took the job, and that's what I tried to do for 6.5 years. That is a journey that doesn't end. You know, it's not like, well, we're all integrated by close of business next Friday. It doesn't work that way. But I do believe there's great utility in it for the simple reason that the sum is greater than the parts. And when you bring the entirety of the intelligence community's capabilities, which are quite considerable, together and work as an integrated enterprise, it's better for the country.
We have some questions from the audience here. I just looked through and they're all really, really good. What is one security threat that the average citizen underestimates and one that they overestimate?
The one that we underestimate profoundly, I believe, is the national security implications of climate change. I know that's controversial, and people argue to the cows come home about how much of it was man-made. It almost doesn't matter. But with the trends in climate and the changes on our planet, and relatedly, the potential dangers of disease, pandemic disease, occasioned by the changes in climate, have profound implications for the globe, not just this country. Just one factoid. You know, we can all see how the ice masses are melting in the Arctic and the Antarctic. And it's pretty simple math, I think, to compute the rise in sea level across the globe. The Earth's population is gravitating to about 60 or so megalopolises, big cities, most all of which are located in coastal areas. So you just think about the implications of that over time. A rising sea level and most of the Earth's population located in these huge urban complexes. It's just one aspect. The life of our arable soil around the on the globe is declining. Arable soil is wearing out. Yet, when you project the population of the Earth, we're not going to have be able to produce enough food to feed. You know, we have issues with that already. Water shortages. There are 35 countries today that are in water extremis. You want to see a really graphic example? Look at Yemen, which is a humanitarian disaster. So that's the area I think that we need to pay a lot more attention to. My colleagues, former colleagues in the intelligence community, need to spend more time and effort and resources studying the national security implications of climate change. The one that gets, I think, too much attention is counterterrorism. Now, there's a reason for that. That's part of our psyche, you know. But having insight into the amount of resources in the intelligence community expended on counterterrorism, and to this administration's credit, now they have singled out our peer competitors as our primary threats, meaning China and Russia, which is very appropriate. And I hope and trust the intelligence community has taken a cue from that and is shifting the tremendous resources that we have committed to counterterrorism to these other adversary targets.
What are the steps the federal and state government should take to protect the integrity of our elections in the future?
Well, this kind of falls into, and this is complicated, into what I'll call two bins. One is sort of the mechanical, administrative, bureaucratic things you can do to secure the voting apparatus, voter registration rolls, and all this sort of thing. When I voted Tuesday, I noted in Fairfax County, Virginia, it was a paper ballot, which got scanned, but they didn't use computers this year. Well, that's the safest way, because if you have a connection, if anyone has a connection to the internet, that is an inherent vulnerability. So to the extent that you can isolate whatever computing you're using from the internet, that is a good thing to do. My impression is, because I don't know, don't have access anymore, is that many states and localities have done things to improve the general security, you know, physical security, electronic security, et cetera, of our voting apparatus. And so far, I think Secretary Nielsen of the Homeland Security Department has said that they've seen no evidence of, you know, Russian interference or hacking. I think, you know, jury may still be out yet on that. The other bin, which is much, much harder to do something about, is how to get people to question what they see, read, or hear on the internet. And that is a much more difficult thing to do, you know.
That's on you. I mean, that's on us.
It's on all of us, yeah. And that's why, by the way, a free and independent press is so damned important today.
I'm going to take you with me everywhere. I'm reading this one out loud. What do I tell my father who insists that Hillary Clinton and the Obama administration are the ones who really colluded with Russia?
Well, tell him it isn't true.
Does that answer the question?
No, I mean, there just isn't any evidence of that, that at least for me, that would, you know, pass the evidentiary bar to suggest any kind of collusion. And on its face, it's kind of crazy, because when the Russian interference began, when it started, the objective, and we saw this in intelligence, the objective was to sow doubt, discord, and discontent in this country. That's all the Russians wanted to do. And unfortunately, they succeeded to a fairly well, because we're such a ripe target for that. The secondary objective was, and this is because of the strong personal animus that Vladimir Putin has for the Clintons, notably Hillary Clinton, because he held her responsible for fomenting what he thought was a color revolution during the Russian election of 2011. So the notion that somehow they, because of this hatred for Hillary Clinton and all that the Russians did to undermine her and her campaign, it's kind of strange to assert just on its face that the Clinton campaign was colluding with the Russians.
One of the things that White House allies say, and I'm paraphrasing here, is that if the Obama administration thought it was so bad, why didn't they stop it in September or October?
That's a great question. It's an FAQ, by the way, John, frequently asked question. Believe me, we had many, many debates and discussions about this in the White House Situation Room as we saw things unfold. The Russians have a long history of interfering in elections, theirs and other people's. And we have records going back to the 60s of the Russians attempting to interfere and influence our elections. But never, never on a scale and as aggressive as what they did in 2016. And that didn't, truth wasn't all revealed in one day. So we saw this building up, and about, in the late summer of 16 and into September, we were really, really concerned about it. And we had a lot of debates about what to do about it. What tempered at the time, you can do coulda, woulda, shouldas all day long. What tempered us at the time was, first, if we really went public about this, let's say President Obama went on primetime television and made a big address about Russian interference. Well, one concern we had was, would we simply be magnifying or amplifying what the Russians were doing, making it more important than it really was? I think another compelling thing that kind of tempered our reaction was the President Obama did not want to be seen as putting his hand on the scale in favor of one candidate and to the disfavor of the other, particularly when then candidate Trump was touting or already pushing the notion that the election was going to be rigged if he didn't win it. And the President Obama didn't want to play to that narrative. Now with the benefit of 2020 hindsight, yeah, I wish we'd done what we did on the 29th of December. I wish we'd accelerated to before the election. Mm-hmm. What we did do, Secretary Jay Johnson, then Secretary of Homeland Security, and I went out with a joint statement which was pretty forthcoming about what the Russians were doing on the 7th of October.
Yeah, that was a big day.
It was a big day. The very same day that the Access Hollywood, or Excess Hollywood as I call it, audio tape came out, and also was, I think, the same day that John Podesta's emails got dumped. So our statement, which we had intended to warn the American public, got completely emasculated.
And there are those who suggest not all of it's completely coincidental, the timing of that. What intelligence security measures taken by President Trump do you agree with? Any good initiatives?
I agreed completely, and I said so on CNN, that the notion of having a summit with Kim Jong-un, I thought that was appropriate for him to accept the invitation. And why do I feel that way? Well, when I was there, it occurred to me that it was very evident to me the North Koreans were stuck on their narrative, and we, the U.S., were stuck on ours. Emblematic of my talking point I was issued to, told to recite. And that the only way those narratives could be changed is if the bigger partner, meaning the United States, changed the narrative. So that's why I supported, that's one example I can think of. I did not agree with withdrawing from the JCPOA, the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, with Iran. I think that was completely the wrong thing to do. But I do try to find things that, I can, be supportive. But
want to keep that security clearance as long
hard.
As you can.
It's kind of hard, yeah.
How do you see further advances in machine learning impacting intelligence and cryptographic analysis? This is a question about artificial intelligence that for me is a frequently asked question. People are always asking about that.
The potential here is huge, particularly for it is huge for the military. There are many realms where it's huge, but I'll just speak to intelligence. Even today, analysts in intelligence spend way too much time correlating, synthesizing, gathering, putting together information before they start to do what only the human mind can deal with, which is the subtleties and nuances of analysis. So artificial intelligence holds the potential for relieving analysts of all these mundane things that can lend themselves to automation, which would profoundly, I think, enhance efficiency, maybe even allow the intelligence community to get smaller. because the intelligence community, as you heard, is a very manpower-intensive activity of necessity. The downside, like all technology, though, I watched the steady stream of big brains troop into the Oval Office during President Obama's time, expressing great concern about artificial intelligence if it isn't appropriately regulated. Now, I personally, I don't feel that way, but I'm not a big brain. But there are those who are very concerned about that. It's like all technology. It's like fire. You know, there's good applications and bad, and so it is with artificial intelligence, but huge potential.
The way I think about AI is I got too much else to worry about. If I start worrying about that, there's just no space left. This is sort of a two-part question that I'm going to end with, and I'll save the second part because I think that's a more hopeful way to end. The first part is this. What concerns you most about President Trump?
Well, I worry about his impulsiveness. That's what is always bothered me about him. And I think as time has gone on, he's gotten more and more confident in his own ability. You know, he's a stable genius and all this, and doesn't need anybody's advice. And my observation, maybe I'm old-fashioned and conventional, but I just think that's risky.
In the tone, do you think you put impulsiveness over the tone as someone who received a mail bomb?
Well, you can't make a cause and effect relationship directly in an evidentiary sense between anything that President Trump has said or done and the actions of the pipe bomber or the despicable thing that happened in the Pittsburgh synagogue. I think everybody, certainly all politicians, but all of us have a responsibility for trying to tone down the rhetoric. Mm-hmm. And that starts with the President of the United States. You know, he is the leader. Mm-hmm. He is the leader, and he sets the tone here. And so he could do a lot more than he's done. In fact, he's done just the opposite, particularly during the run-up to the election. To heighten divisiveness and polarization and incite people and make, some of these wackos feel as though they have license to invoke violence.
And I want to close with this. Are you hopeful about the future of the country? Why or why not?
So the only argument that my collaborator, Trey Brown, who is phenomenal. I would never have written a book without Trey. He was my speechwriter for my last 3 years at DNI. The only argument we had about the whole book was how to end it. And so we wrote a very dark outlook. We didn't like that. Then we wrote a happy face version. And we didn't like that. So my managing editor at Viking was my publisher, Ricott. He got involved and helped us. And what we simply ended up saying was that the United States has endured and survived very huge national traumas in the past, obviously the Civil War, the case in point, and one I lived through, my war, Southeast Asia, and its aftermath. Very, very traumatic, but in both cases, the United States emerged from those traumas the better and the stronger for it, and we just stopped without making any prognosis.
On that note, copies of Facts and Fears, Hard Truths from a Life in Intelligence, they are on sale, and Director Clapper is going to sign them after the talk. It's terrific. And there are really wonderful anecdotes in there and lessons as well. And I learned, I have to say, a ton. Even getting to talk to you as much as I do, I learned so much. So, Director Clapper, thank you so much for the book. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much. Thank you.